Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning.
It is indeed a good morning too, isn't it? That was awesome. Thank you both for that. And of course, I wanted to sing along on most of those songs too, or shout amen when we got to that. But good morning. Welcome to everybody. Welcome to our guests this morning. Welcome to some guests joining us on Facebook. I'm Brian. I'm the pastor here. I'm blessed and honored to be the pastor here at Paxtonville. Great to have everyone with us today, and it's always a great day when we're able to do that, when we're able to gather together and be with one another in praise and worship of that amazing God that we serve. A couple quick things, announcements. First of all, I think we'll have some happy people about this. No more tearing off slips of paper from your bulletin. You'll notice that we make it easier on you even. You don't have to do any work other than fill in. There's a connection card we're going to start using now. Has same basic information on it. Always be this nice bright color, easy to spot. Also, we'll make that easier on Lynn to separate it from those white envelopes when she's going through the offering plate after worship service. But just take a moment at some time during the service and fill in. If you've done it recently, when we have your contact info, you can skip that part. But guests, especially if you're joining us for the first time, I'm not going to fill your inbox with spam, I promise on that. But we just want to have the chance to be able to reach out and say hello and thank you. Also, another insert, of course, is the EUP guide, placed there to jot notes on today's service. Speaking of stuff like that, you probably have your cell phone out to find out how long the pastor is going to be talking today. But feel free to check in on Facebook. Let folks know you're here and why, and you can jot and feel free to post anything that strikes your hearts this morning. And I pray there'll be lots of those as we go through our day. Now, friends in Facebook land, as we go through worship experiences each week, there are certain times that sometimes we have to go silent. One of them is going to be right now as we share some private stuff with each other. But we're going to try to keep our things brief and come back to you just as soon as we can. So we ask you to please bear with us. And while we're doing that, if you'd be in prayer for us as well as for yourself. Thank you. have our friends rejoin us in Facebook, and we'll start with our first praise song of the morning. I invite you to please rise as you are able to do so, and let's join together in singing. Today is the day.
Casting my cares aside, I'm leaving my past behind. I'm setting my heart and mind on you, Jesus. I'm reaching my hand to yours, believing there's so much more. Knowing that all you have in store for me is good. It's good. Today is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Today is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. And I won't worry about tomorrow. I'm trusting in what you say. Today is the day. Today is the day. I'm putting my fears aside. I'm leaving my doubts behind. I'm giving my hopes and dreams to you, Jesus. I'm reaching my hand to yours, believing there's so much more. Knowing that all you have in store for me is good, is good.
Sing it out.
Today is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Today is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. And I won't worry about tomorrow. I'm trusting in what you say. Today is the day. Today is the day.
Coming up is an Echo Park. And you'll lead, ladies, you'll follow.
Upon your truth,
I will stand upon your truth.
All my days I live for you.
All my days I live for you.
Yes, I will stand upon your truth.
I will stand upon your truth.
All my days I live for you.
All my days I live.
Today is day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Today is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. And I won't worry about tomorrow. I'm giving you my fears and sorrows. When you lead me, I will follow. Trusting in what you say. Today is the day. Today is the day. Today is the day. Today is the day. Today is the day.
God is good.
All the time.
Jesus offers us assurance that asking God to act in the world is not a waste of breath. An important part of prayer is petitioning the Holy One, naming needs. We are called to become mindful of the needs of the world and our own need to remember the source of all gifts. Come, let us worship together. Please be seated, and do we have any kids that want to come join me up front? Good morning. Oh, everybody's tired. Good morning.
Good morning.
That's better. Good morning. All right. All right. Okay. That's all right. That's all right. That's all right. You're tired. I am too. Lots of tired people. But I bet you're excited. School starts next week. Yeah. Yay. The excitement is overwhelming. You can't wait to see your classroom. I bet there's a lot of people that you haven't seen, a lot of your friends that you haven't seen for a couple months now. And some of you might be having, you probably all got new teachers compared to last year. And your friend might move, that's a bummer. That's a bummer. That's a bummer. So are you worried about school? A little bit of worry? A little bit of worry? You're excited. Excited is good. Excited is good. Okay, so we've been talking about the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples. We call it the Lord's Prayer. And So we'll go over what we learned the last couple weeks, and if you weren't here, that's okay. We can start all over learning it, and then we'll add the new one, and we'll all be together on this. We're about, well, we're 3/5 of the way through after today. That's math for you to get started on school. Well, anyway, it says, and you guys, if you can read it with me. We're just following along. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. I skipped one. I had them out of order. Nobody noticed? Ha ha. That was a little trick. That was a trick. The big page is today only because I ran out of smaller paper. Well, does the order matter? Is it important to keep things in a particular order when we're talking to God? Well, sometimes, yeah. Sometimes it is. Well, the alphabet's kind of important to keep in order, isn't it? Yeah. And it's important to keep them all letters. You can't go A, B, C, 4, 3, 2, X, Z, W. That doesn't make sense, does it? Yes, yes, yes. Just like Twinkle Twinkle, use the right tune. That's right. And numbers would also be important to keep numbers in a particular order, right? Mr. Hetrick is here somewhere. He probably has to brush up on his math before he starts teaching next week. 1, 2, 4, 5. No, I skipped something. 3, right? So those things are important to keep in order. And exactly. You got to know the order of the numbers in order to do your math. Well, God just likes it when we talk to him. So we can pray just about any order we want. When you're doing your prayers at night or at whenever you guys pray, you know, whenever you guys pray, maybe you always keep it in the same order. What's a good thing about praying in a particular order? What happens when you do things in order? Well, when you do things in an order, then you know that you didn't miss something, right? When you're doing something in a particular order, maybe it's cleaning your room or getting yourself ready in the morning or at night before you go to bed. If you're always wash your face, then brush your teeth, then put on your pajamas, then say your prayers, then get in bed, then you know you don't miss anything. But if you go in a random order, you might forget to brush your teeth. Yeah, see? Right? So sometimes you forget, and that's okay. And so if you're saying a prayer to God, you don't have to say it in a particular order. You could pray for mom and dad and grandma and grandpa, and then you can skip around to other people that you're praying for. But if you keep it in the same order, then you always remember to say everybody. So Jesus gave his disciples a prayer, and we use the same prayer today, and we keep it in the same order that Jesus gave it, just so we make sure that we say everything that he asked us to say. This is now we're going to do it in order, okay? You guys help me out? And we're going to get to the last one, which is our new one for today. Right. Your apps. That's right. So we're going to say it in order. Please. All right. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And that's where we're at today. You'll get there. You'll learn the prayer, especially if we keep doing it in order. Then we can remember the whole thing. So let's have a little prayer. You guys can help me out, and then head on back to your seats. Dear God, thank you for loving us. Help us to always remember you. Amen. Thanks for coming up. You kids are awesome.
I don't know about you, but I think we all become a child during those children's moments.
Lord, I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you.
Spoken right there on that song, "Oh God, how we need you." Let's bow our heads for a second. Father, I just thank you for who you are in your Son, Lord. And I just ask that you help us to be able to just communicate to you and what we're learning and is just talking to you. That's all, like you're our best friend, Lord, and as you truly are. So help us to understand that. Just open ourselves up to you, and that's all you're asking from us. In Jesus' name I pray. Today's scripture, Matthew chapter 6, verses 9 through 13. In this manner, therefore, pray. Our Father in heaven. Wow. Hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. This is the word of the Lord.
I'm chuckling up here. Our Sunday school class, the last couple of weeks anyway, we spend 3 weeks on 1 week session. We're so advanced in how we do things. We're like on a speed course or something. It takes us 3 weeks to do one. And it's about, it's called The Grave Robber. And the subtitle to that is Letting Jesus, now I'm forgetting how it says, How Jesus Can Make Your Impossible Possible. How Jesus Can Make Your Impossible Possible. So guess what it's based on? It's based on miracles. And one thing we talked about with the miracles was that in order for a miracle, God uses the natural to create the supernatural. And quite often the natural is us. Well, folks, this morning you saw a miracle. And I was the, not unnatural, supernatural. You saw a miracle this morning, and I was the unwitting natural participant in that because it was in my mistake that God created a miracle. I did not intentionally have those cue cards out of order for the kids. Wow. But thanks God. Turned it around into a story. Anyway, that was pretty cool. So good morning again, and thanks for coming today. And take notes, feel free to do that, or like I said, send those out on Facebook. If anything you experience this morning brings a question to your mind, if you have a question about something I say or something from the scripture, my cell number is in there, shoot me a text and we'll try to get to it at the end of the service. Facebook, sorry I'm not giving out my cell phone that freely, but if you comment on the stream, we'll try to answer your questions as well. So we're in our study, and today is Give Us This Day Our Daily Bread. Give Us This Day Our Daily Bread. Now, there's an old expression, and I'm sure you've heard it before, that bread is the staff of life. Yeah, cool. See, you guys know it. You guys know that. I think there are like 5 different scriptures in the Bible that make reference to that in some way, shape, or form. And that's where the expression comes from, that bread is the staff of life. You know, we might misunderstand that because we're living so far past when the expression came from. You know how things change, how words change? Ravi shared a story with me this morning about Davy Jones, that Davy Jones locker actually comes from a 1940s race car driver. When I always thought that it had to do with Davy Jones the pirate or something like that. At least that's what it's been changed into. So that was cool. So we learn these expressions. We think we know what something means when it means something different. Do you know what I'm talking about? There's the expression, that's the pot calling the kettle black. What's the origin of that expression? And it dates back to how cauldrons would get blackened because of the soot. Over open fires, etc., etc. So if you look at it one way, it means one thing. If you look at it a different way, it means something else. Well, we might think of staff as something other than what they meant back in biblical times. So here's the thing for you. When they talk about a staff, which I wish I had one here right now, we are talking about a literal walking stick. We're talking about a literal walking stick. We're not talking about a group of employees or something like that. We're talking about a literal walking stick. And when we think about using a walking stick, especially back in, you know, the wilderness times where you didn't have really good shoe coverings, foot coverings, you didn't have paved roads, you had lots of rocks and things, it would be very difficult to move forward without a staff, without that walking stick. And I'm sure folks that have had to use walking sticks because of injuries, because of broken bones, or because of age, you can understand that it's hard to move forward without that staff. So when they talk about bread being the staff of life, it's that thing without which you can't move forward. It's the thing without which you can't move forward. And there are over 300 scriptures, 300 references to bread in the Bible. over 300 references to bread in the Bible. So here's your biblical quiz for today. We're going to see how many of you guys can fill in the blanks on this. It's actually a pretty easy test. But in one of the very first stories in the Bible, the first story that tries to explain how humanity has this depraved condition that we have, this sinful nature, and God is sending Adam and Eve out of the garden, and God says, by the sweat of your brow, you will eat bread. Thank you, bread. Wow. What was the theme for today? Okay. You will eat bread. Okay, so then we got a bunch of chapters later, and we've got Esau selling his birthright to his younger brother Jacob, basically for a bowl of porridge and some. Then we've got years later with Jacob having all those kids, 12 sons, and all their wives and grandchildren, etc., etc., etc. And there's a famine in the land, and somebody says, well, I hear that they have in Egypt, so let's go to Egypt and look for some. And they end up spending over 400 years there, most of them in slavery. And on the night they're going to be free, the night before they're going to be free, they're trying to get stuff together and have this special meal. And Moses says, come on, come on, come on, hurry up. We got to get out of here. There was no time for the yeast to work on the dough. And so they had to eat unleavened. There we go. Jesus comes along in Matthew, and he's in the desert. He's gone for 40 days without eating. Which probably just symbolic for a whole long time without eating anything. And Satan comes along and shows him a rock and says, hey, you're hungry. I know you're hungry. If you're the Son of God, which, you know, I believe you are too, you could turn this into... But Jesus says, no. So then on his last night of existence on this earth, he gathers in that room with his closest friends to have a meal, and he lifts up and says that this is my body given for you. Take and eat. So, excellent job. You guys did a great job. A little slow starting. So it's your early scriptures you need to work on. You caught on as we moved up in the Bible, which is great. So there's all those references to bread. Now maybe we get a better understanding of why it's so important, and why Jesus is telling us to ask for our bread. The prayer doesn't start with this. Of course, Jesus starts the prayer with his disciples, and he tells them, our Abba, Papa. Our Papa, we say our Father, but our Papa, because God wants this close relationship, so we're talking directly to God. We're starting off the prayer with the address to God and submitting to God's will, saying it's what you want done here is what I want to be about. And then Jesus says, but then it's okay to pray for yourself. Now that we've done this, we can start on the other stuff, and you can start to pray for your own needs and what you want. And he says, pray for your daily bread. Well, how does that work? Right? How does that work? It's not like I sit here and close my eyes and say, give me this day my daily bread, peek open my eye and see bread. Well, I will if I turn and look at the altar since they have all these loaves here. But we don't go home and say this prayer with an empty dish in front of us and then poof, a cloud of smoke and there's steak and potatoes and green beans, casserole, and all that kind of stuff. Do we? Doesn't work that way. If it was, maybe I'd change it from daily bread to daily pizza, or daily ice cream, or something like that. But that's not how it works. And that's not what we're praying for. Because that's not how the prayer works, and that's not how God provides for us. God provides for us with the basic needs. God does provide us with this earth that we have been given, this creation that we've been given. God does provide us with stuff that grows with which we can make bread. God provides us with people who work the land so that we don't have to, maybe, because they're gifted in that and they love to do that. And God has people who are gifted and talented and love to drive trucks so that they can carry that wheat from one place to another, and then it gets processed, and then it gets shipped everywhere, and then it finally comes to the grocery store where we go and get it. because we're able to, and have our daily bread. That's how it works. But I had a key phrase in there, and I hope you caught that. Because we're able to. Because we're able to. And there are a lot of people who aren't able to. And so God provides for their daily bread in a different way. God provides for their daily bread by sending us. God provides for their daily bread by sending us. By sending us to, yeah, to write checks, to food pantries, or to bag up groceries and take them to food pantries, or go down to the soup kitchen and volunteer an hour or two on Thanksgiving Day, because we probably would have eaten too much of food on our own, and we really don't need it, so that somebody else can have their daily bread. We started this series saying that when we say a prayer so often and so quickly, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven, give us this day our daily bread, forgive us not our trespasses as we have, forgive us our trespasses as we have forgiven those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Did anybody time that? It's probably less than 15 seconds. But not only by saying it so quickly and so repetitively do we miss what is meant by things or take for granted such things. It's when we're so blessed at having our daily bread so accessible to us that we forget how powerful that section of that prayer is. For those who don't have anything. Jesus says, give us this day our daily bread. This day. Not to pray for bread to eat tomorrow, but to eat bread today. Because church, it's a matter of trust. It's a matter of trust. It's asking God for what I need today and not being concerned about tomorrow. You know, this does, in the Gospel of Matthew, this prayer is offered by Jesus, taught by Jesus in the Sermon on the Mount. And when he finishes up this prayer, he goes on to explain a couple of things. You know what one of the passages right after it, well, right after this, he goes into explanation about the forgiveness part, which we tend to not to do so well on. But then he goes into a big description about don't worry about tomorrow, what you will eat, what you will drink, what you will wear, etc., 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 etc. Only worry about today. It's a matter of trust. When the Israelites, after they'd been freed from the slavery and they were wandering through the desert and they didn't have anything to eat and they complained to God and God sent them manna, what is that, from heaven with which they baked, with which they baked bread, God said, only collect enough for today. Now what happened if they tried to collect enough for today and tomorrow? It rotted. Because they didn't trust, they were worried about tomorrow, and didn't trust God to provide what they needed today, tomorrow, and tried to get what they needed tomorrow, today. It's a matter of trust when we say, this day, our daily bread. Now, lastly, daily bread. Why do I say, this day, daily bread? That almost doesn't make sense, right? Like doesn't it sound repetitive in some ways to say this day our daily bread? Well, the word that we translate daily is epiousimia. Don't quote me on the pronunciation on that, because it's all Greek to me. When you're translating from one language into another, of course, it's pretty easy for us. All we have to do anymore is check with Google or Siri or something like that and use a translate function. Say a word in there and whatever, what does this mean in Spanish or Lithuanian or Icelandic and all that stuff, and it spits it right back out at you. Well, kids, us older people, we didn't have it quite so easy. We actually had to use a book called a dual language dictionary from French to English to French dictionary to look up the word and try to translate it. But even we were fortunate compared to the people who came up with those books in the first place, right? When you're translating something, if you're able to look it up, that's great, it's easy. What about when it's not there at all, right? What about when it's not there at all? Well, what you have to do, what they have to do when they're coming up with the best explanations or descriptions of a word, best translations of a word, you have to look up where it's used and how it's used. You look up the context of the passage. And we'll say verse since we're talking Bible mostly today anyway. You look up the context, where is the word used? And you look up how many times it's used in the Bible. And you might look in some of the other documents from the same era, so like first century Greek texts, to see how often epiusemia is used. The more times a word is used, the easier it is to zoom in on a definition. Does that make sense? If a word is used 200 times in the context of the word, you're able to zoom in and say, oh, okay, this means this. Oh, that's a tree. They're talking about a tree. Okay, because it's used so many times. The more infrequently a word is used, the harder it is to pinpoint what it means. Guess how many times epiusemia is used in anything? Twice. In Matthew's version of the Lord's Prayer and in Luke's version of the Lord's Prayer. They can't find it used anywhere else in any first century Greek document. So you know what they think? They think that the authors, that Jesus' disciples, made up a Greek word to translate something that he said in Aramaic. Something that he said in Aramaic. And it's actually like two things put together. Epi means support or base. And eusemia is a word that actually, well, we don't use the Greek version of it, but every time we say one of the creeds, like the Apostles' Creed and the Nicene Creed, we're using words based on the word eusemia, where we're talking about the relationship of God and Jesus. It's substance or essence. So daily bread, Jesus was actually using a word that, quite possibly, based on this epiusemia, meaning the base substance. The base substance. The base essence. The supporting essence. Bread. Well, if there's something that's the base, then there's something that's more important that sits on it. And what is that? Well, I'm testing you again. When Jesus was wandering in the desert, when he was out in the desert for all those days, all that time, and he got so hungry that Satan came up and said, turn this rock into, and you can eat it. And Jesus says, no, because we've been told man does not live on alone, but on the word of God, on the relationship with God. So now, those seven words, give us this day our daily bread. Seven mean a whole lot more, don't they? The staff of life. We're asking for the staff of life. We're asking for that with which we cannot move forward. We're asking God to use us to be that bread for somebody else. We're asking God for the strength to trust God for today and for tomorrow without worrying about tomorrow. And we're asking God to help us draw closer to Him. To not let the hunger of our bellies for this day's ice cream to tear down that relationship or to be more important than drawing closer to God, but to let a body filled with bread be merely the support on which everything else is built. 7 words. Give us this day our daily bread. Gracious, amazing God, we give you thanks for this day. Today is the day. Today is the day to worship you, to praise you, to give you thanks for all the ways with which you have blessed us. And God, sometimes we're just completely blown away by your power, your strength, your grace, and your ability to use us as weak and fallible as we are to do some pretty amazing things sometimes. We're sorry, God, that sometimes we miss those little things when those little things really are the big things. We don't deserve your love, Lord. And yet, Papa, you send your love anyway. You shower us with grace upon grace upon grace, fully greater than our sin, that's for sure. So, Papa, we say we're sorry for forgetting about you and forgetting about neighbor. And we humbly accept your forgiveness. And then we boldly ask for more, asking you to give us the strength we need to do just a little bit better today than we did yesterday. Papa, I felt blessed today, blessed indeed by our brother Ravi coming and joining us today, and to be here with Debbie and sharing their gift of music this morning. Your presence has been felt. We thank you for the gifts that you have given to them and the gift of music in general, how it stirs our hearts and moves us. We've shared the joy of good leadership, people showing, leading youth in different ways, Lord, but showing youth good morals through the sport of football. So we give you thanks for those folks, and we ask for your continued blessings upon those coaches and helpers and everybody involved in that. And Papa, we shared the fact that school is starting back soon. Some going back this week, oh my goodness, and others going back next week. So we pray for all those kids, all those youth, all those teachers, all those administrators, all those custodians and cafeteria workers and everybody who is involved in the education system. And lest I forget, including the school boards themselves. We lift them all to you, God, with joy on our hearts and yes, with concern. We pray for good years. We pray for good education. Papa, that moves us towards the things that are weighing on our hearts. And we pray for Ben in advance of his surgery, knowing it's coming in a couple weeks, but we pray for him. We pray for Janet and her diagnosis of cancer, a word that scares us. We pray for Mary as she's getting ready to schedule her surgery, and for Donnie and his diagnosis. We pray for Jackson, rejoicing that surgery went well, but so concerned over the pain that he is experiencing. We do ask, Papa, that the medicine will work and he will be able to rest and heal and get back to the strength that he needs. We pray for Jen, who is having her surgery this week. God, we pray for Keith and for Tina and the new diagnosis, the additional stuff that's going on in their lives. We pray that the treatments will work for him. We pray for peace and comfort, and where we can be a part of that, please show us the way. We do pray for all who mourn, Lord. Grief and death is, well, it is a part of life, and it's sort of a universal equator, making us all equal in some ways as we deal with grief. So we pray for the family of Crystal Schaefer, whom you have graciously received into your presence. We pray for the family of Roger Schombach, whom you have welcomed into your arms. And we pray for the Dirk family, dealing with the loss of their mother, whom we trust you have also received with those words, "Well done, good and faithful servant." And God, we do have a piece of paper with a whole bunch of ink on it, but it's so much more than that, because it is a list of people whom we love and care about. But Papa, you love and care about them even more, and you know their needs. So we lift them to you and ask you to help us to trust that you will answer their needs as they should be met. We pray for this world, Lord, so broken and hurting, that the leaders will find ways to work for peace and for justice, including our president and Congress and Senate. And we pray for the church universal, that your name will be praised and your kingdom expanded. And in particular, we do pray for the United Methodist Church. And we pray for the Susquehanna Conference, of which we're a part. We pray for our bishop, Bishop Park, for the whole cabinet, and in particular for RDS, Larry Leland, as he shepherds us here in Lewisburg District. We pray for all those who take care of us and keep us safe, military at home and abroad, local police departments. We pray for the emergency responders who come to our aid when we need it most, for firefighters who rush in when others rush out, and for emergency medical personnel who come to our aid when we need it most. Lastly, God, we do ask that you'll send to us the folks who nobody else wants and think they won't be wanted here, and that you'll send us to them rather than just waiting around, so that we can show them that we do care and that we can extend to them a sign of your love and your grace. Use us to be the natural through which you perform the supernatural. We lift all of these prayers to you, Papa, in the name of your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever, and whose words we now use. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Give us our sins. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory of the world. Thank you. Church, as you leave today, we're going to be offering each family your daily bread, a loaf of bread. And we ask that you take it home, you sit down as a family, you share this daily bread, and you thank God who is providing it to you. Perhaps you can even invite somebody else who may not have it today, or provide them with their daily bread each time you see it and think about that. Amen. Now, special music. Reception of new members. Woo-hoo! So I'm going to invite Zeb and Britt to come forward, and you can bring Ace with you too, no problem there. And Tommy, if you'd also join me up here. You know, this is the time, of course, when, the pastor's done preaching, we pass the plates around. And I say that, you know, we have more to give to God than just our money. We give God our very selves. We give God our very selves. That's what we're doing today, as this family wishes to join us. And please follow along on the screens or in your books. And so, brothers and sisters in Christ, through the sacrament of baptism, we are initiated into Christ's holy church. We are incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation and given new birth through water and the Spirit. All of this is God's gift offered to us without price. Through confirmation or through the profession of faith, we renew the covenant that is declared at our baptism, acknowledge what God is doing for us, and affirm our commitment to Christ's holy church. So Zeb, I have a few questions for you. On behalf of the whole church, not just in this room, but beyond, I ask you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness? Nope. Reject the evil powers of this world and repent of your sin? Do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in His grace, and promise to serve Him as your Lord, in union with the church, which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races? According to the grace given to you, will you remain a faithful member of Christ's holy church and serve as Christ's representative in the world? As members of Christ's universal church, this is for both of you now, I'm bringing you in. Will you be loyal to Christ through the United Methodist Church and do all in your power to strengthen its ministries? As members of this congregation, Paxtonville UMC, will you faithfully participate in its ministries by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? Members of the household of God, I commend these persons to your love and your care. Do all in your power to increase their faith, confirm their hope, and perfect them in love.
We give thanks for all that God has already given you, and we welcome you in Christian love.
As members together with you in the body of Christ, and in this congregation of the United Methodist Church, we renew our covenant faithfully to participate in the ministries of the church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness, that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. The God of all grace, who has called us to eternal glory in Christ, establish you and strengthen you by the power of the Holy Spirit, that you may live in grace and peace. Amen. Amen. Let us welcome our new brother and sister. as the ushers get ready and start coming forward, let's have a moment of prayer. Gracious, amazing, awesome God, we give you thanks for all of the ways you have blessed us. You have given us so much, Papa. And right now we're just going to return a little bit of it back to you. We thank you for the ability to do this. We thank you for the giving hearts through which this is done. We ask that you will bless the ministries and the individuals who are blessed by them from this church on behalf of you. In your Son Jesus' name we pray, amen. I guess I did a good job. I don't have any text questions this morning. I thought I had one, but it was just an email. Princess Cruise Line wants my money, I guess. Apparently. Don't know how you get on some of those things sometimes. But again, I won't be doing that. If you put your information on your attendance card, I'm not going to be filling your email up with spam. But I do invite you to please rise as you are able to do so, and let's join together in our hymn of parting. This morning, leaning on the everlasting arms, trusting.
Thank you. Thank you.